This episode is made possible by the generosity of our listeners. Thank you.
Welcome to the Creation Science
for Kids
Show. Wisdom loves analogies. And where does she turn to find examples to compare her wealth to? The created world. After examining Proverbs, we take a look at a fun animal article in Answers Magazine, a publication of Answers in Genesis. Then it's time to take a course on dinosaurs with Rockman Pat. The Lord, I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart, in the company of the upright, in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of splendor and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and merciful. Psalm 111, verses 1 through 4. This is episode 74 of the podcast where we learn about Jesus, our Creator, and His amazing world. Hi, I'm Sherry Fields, your host, and I'm joined today by my co-host, Samuel.
Hi.
And Stephen.
Hi.
To follow along with what we're looking at, check out the show notes, creationscience4kids.com/Tenrec, T-E-N-R-E-C, or 074 if you forget how to spell them. And be sure to listen all the way to the end for the punny science joke of the day. All right, we're continuing on through Proverbs 8, and this is the last stretch of verses before we get to the part directly talking about how God used wisdom when he created everything. So we're going to read verses 18 through 20. Stephen, would you read them for us, please?
My fruit is better than gold, yea, than the fine gold. And my revenue than the choice silver. I lead in the way of righteousness, in the midst of the path of judgment, that I may cause those that love me to inherit substance, and I will fill their treasures.
Very good. Thank you. Okay, so this sounds like a lot of Proverbs where it's saying it's better to have what than gold and wealth? Who's been talking?
God.
Specifically, what about God? Do you remember? Wisdom. Wisdom has been talking, and in earlier verses it mentions how, like, even your rulers and judges need wisdom, and how it's good to find it when you're young. And now wisdom is finishing up by saying, if you get me, my fruit is better than gold. Okay, so fruit. Why would it be talking about fruit? What is fruit? Just in the plain sense, nothing fancy.
Fruit is the stuff you get off of trees.
Mm-hmm. And what's inside of a fruit?
Juice.
Juice. Why does a tree make it? What's down inside of a fruit?
Seeds.
Seeds, yes. And why did God give us fruits the way they are? Why didn't he just make all trees have little bitty seeds that nobody would want to eat because they'd be so small? Why did he give big fruits like apples and oranges and things? What do we do with it?
We can eat it.
We can eat it. And a lot of them are very sweet. Like Samuel, you were talking about, they have juice. So fruit is something that we experience in the real world. We can see how it's a blessing to us. If you plant and care for a young fruit tree and it grows up and nothing kills it, you will get rewarded with lots and lots more fruit than you planted, right?
Yes.
Okay, so she's using to compare the investment we make in wisdom to fruit. She's using the natural world to compare something that's in your mind that you can't really see or hold in your hands. So what else does she say? She says the fruit, the results, the blessings that you get from wisdom is better than
gold.
Gold. What is gold?
Gold is a very expensive rock.
Not rock. You were right.
Mineral.
Yeah, it's a metal. And it's actually, do you remember that list of all your basic elements that right in the middle of all those weird names, there is gold?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So gold is one of the basic types of atoms we have in the world. It's a metal. And you're right. If you took all the gold that we've ever dug up in the whole world and squished it together, it would make a block much smaller than a skyscraper. And no one else in the world would have any for rings or jewelry or computers or anything. That's how little there is in the whole world. So comparing it to gold tells us that it is highly valuable. Why do we like gold so much?
It's beautiful.
It is beautiful. And now she also compares it to choice silver. Silver is also beautiful. I actually prefer looking at it because I like the cooler color. But if you don't use silver, do you know what happens to it? It gets this kind of tarnish to it. It turns a weird sort of brownish dull color. That does not happen to gold. So gold is highly valued. It's easy to work with. It's one of the softer metals, and you can even pound it with a hammer all the way so thin it's only a single molecule thick. So there are some places where a whole roof will be covered in gold, like the Capitol Dome out in Colorado, where they dug up a bunch. That's something they decided to do to their Capitol building. And it shines in the sun, and it's lasted for 100 years, even though it's super thin, the actual gold coating on it. So that's what wisdom says. If you get wisdom, that's even better than this thing that we greatly desire, gold and then silver, another metal. When Abraham wanted to buy a piece of land so he could bury Sarah and have a sort of like a cemetery, but it was a cave instead, do you remember what he bought it with? Did he give them sheep?
Silver?
Yeah, he used silver. Now, back then, they didn't make it into round coins and mint it, but they had pieces of silver. And that was what he used to purchase a piece of land way back during the Ice Age still. So that's something people have highly valued forever. Because if you remember back in Genesis 2, describing the land of Eden, and it talks about the rivers flowing out. It mentions that one of the rivers had gold in that land. So it has been valued since right after the world was started. Okay, so then she says, I lead in the way of righteousness in the midst of the paths of judgment. What is a way and what are paths? Have you ever walked on a path?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Where is a path that's easier to think of like this? Because we tend to have rather fancy ones here in America.
In the forest?
Uh-huh. So when you think of that path to walk through the forest, what's the difference between that and a city street?
One is actually nature and one is just rocks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So for our city roads, we have taken things that God gave us in nature, but change it so that you don't have weeds growing and there are trees usually along the sides. We plant them on purpose because they're good for us and they're beautiful. But yeah, if you take a path through the woods or across a prairie or anyway, it's probably not going to be coated with asphalt like a road or covered in cement like our sidewalks. Why are there paths through the woods where we go walking? Did the city people plan them?
No.
How did they get there then?
God made them?
No, he didn't. That's the kind of thing he leaves for us. Yeah, so anything that walks around makes a path. There are lots of animal paths. You can follow where the deer go, and there are even smaller ones where small animals will have paths to their favorite places between their burrows and their places they want to eat or hang out. Ours through the woods are just where people have wanted to walk. Like along the crest of the hill. And when people walk back and forth, you get this bare spot where there aren't a bunch of the bushes and plants and flowers and things. So what is a path made out of in the forest?
Sticks.
There are some sticks which have fallen, but that's not because we wanted them.
Dirt.
Dirt is made out of dirt, the bare stuff without the plants there. And that's how you can tell where the path is. And that's one of the things I like. Throughout the Bible, you have the way being described. Remember, the first Christians were called followers of the way. So what I love about it is it gives you the idea that somebody else has already gone that way and tramped it down so you can tell where to walk. And we are following in that way. The way of righteousness, who would have tramped it down first? and the paths of judgment. Who would have gone before us?
God.
And specifically here, it says here, I lead in the way of righteousness in the midst of the paths of judgment. Who is the I again?
Wisdom.
So wisdom, God's wisdom. So you're perfectly right saying it's God, has gone before us, laid out a path by walking it. What's cool, although this is in the Old Testament, we see that actually happening by Jesus. Did Jesus take a bus to get where he was going?
No.
What did he do most of the time when he was traveling? Sometimes he would have his disciples row him across a lake. But most of the time, how did he get from Galilee down to Jerusalem?
He walked.
Jesus did a lot of walking. So I think it's very fitting. It helps me to really picture what it's like to follow God when it's like this foot and that foot and the way that God has been before. And even when I can't see where it's going, he knows where he's going, of course. So it's another natural world analogy. When you're walking on a path through the forest and you can tell it's well used, there aren't a bunch of dead trees, there aren't a bunch of weeds growing through it, that it's been used a lot, do you worry that it's just going to stop and leave you lost somewhere?
No,
because you know other people have been and they have gotten where they're going. And for all you know, they could have been walking the other way. So you know it's a safe way that's going to lead you somewhere interesting or worth traveling to. All right, then the last is substance and treasures, that those that love me will inherit substance. Do you remember what inherit is? If you inherit something, what happened?
I don't know.
So to inherit is when somebody passes something on to you. Usually that happens when someone dies. They don't have to. They can say, okay, I don't need this anymore. Here, I'm going to give what was mine that I have used, and you may have it. It is now yours. A lot of times that's something family does. Doesn't have to be. You can have somebody who's just a friend realize you could use this and pass it on to you. So wisdom passes on what?
Substance.
So that's a way of saying wealth. In the plain world, that just means you will get lots of stuff, which comes in handy when you need to do things. If somebody gives you, you're just starting out farming and they say, I'm too old to use my plow anymore. Here's my plow and here's my bag of seed and all that stuff to get you going. That would be a real help if you're just getting started, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
So wisdom gives you what you need in order to live your life. And treasures, when you think of treasures, what do you think of?
Money.
What else? If you think of like a pirate treasure where pirates found a ship full of treasure and they put it in a box.
Gold.
What else?
Diamond.
Right. Gemstones, which those are also from the natural world, things that we value because they're hard to find and they're very beautiful. And like diamonds and sapphires and stuff, they last. We've dug up treasures from the Egyptians from 2,000 years before Jesus. They can last a long time. So things that are valuable in themselves and that aren't going to just vanish if you take good care of them, if you don't just give them away for a quick party. Wisdom will fill your treasure so that you have what you need. Now, does that mean everybody who follows God is going to be rich? No, especially not with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is far better than having God say, if you follow me, I'll give you a long life and take good care of you and make sure you don't have droughts and you have lots of children and you live to be an old, old person. But you'll only hear from me every few years if I decide to send a prophet. It's much, much better the way we have it. Now we have the Holy Spirit to help us every day. He usually gives us what we need, unless something's gone wrong and there are evil people around. He does care for our needs, but he gives us something far better than being rich, which is to have the Holy Spirit with his peace and his love and his joy and his courage and all those things. But what I love is that this whole passage is stuffed with real world analogies of gold and treasure and paths, because the natural world. We can see, we can walk on those paths. We can eat fruit and experience these things. And that helps us to then picture when he's talking about things like wisdom and what it does. Okay. Now, it's been a while, quite a number of podcasts since I mentioned the Answers magazine. I don't actually get it. My parents do. So I asked to borrow this particular one. This is a March, April 2018 issue. It's really beautiful. It's got pictures of what on the cover?
Shells.
Right. Seashells. And the title is The Ultimate Beach House. So I was looking through it, and of course, they always have really delightful articles, keep you up to date on some of the newer things happening in science and helping with how to think as a Christian, starting from the Bible first. And I hadn't gotten very far in when I saw this picture. What does that look like?
Tenrec?
Yeah, it is a tenrec. Which is what? Is it a tree?
No. It's an animal.
It's an animal, and it's got here around its nose, what are all those? What do we call that?
Prickles.
Well, back further, they're prickles. But it's fur, so this is definitely in what family of animals or classification of animals has fur?
Porcupines.
Way, way bigger. Even your body is in this classification.
Mammals.
Yes. And one of the things I wasn't sure from the article, because it's fairly short, but they are not marsupials. These are proper mammals. Okay. So I had never heard of a tenrec before. So again, if you want to see the show notes and you don't have an app that you can click straight through, you'll want to be able to spell T-E-N-R-E-C. And they remind us, they've got prickles, so they remind us a bit of porcupines or hedgehogs. But one of the things that's fun, a few years back, I had studied echidnas, and they are marsupials, where they have the itty-bitty babies and then may have the pouch for them to finish developing in. And they are confusing for evolutionists because they're a bit like hedgehogs and porcupines. So it is with the tenrecs, that they have spines, but they are not, obviously not closely related. They're not that genetically similar to porcupines. So they don't fit neatly into one of those trees of life that evolutionists are constantly wanting to make for everything. This article, actually, we'll read a bit of it, but we also did some research on our own and found some interesting videos. The one that we watched that showed the most interesting thing they can do with their prickles. Do you remember what it was, Stephen?
Yes, they can make a high-pitched sound so that they can find each other.
Yeah, what this process is called is dridulation. First of all, it's how when we listen to a violin, that's what's making the music, is the vibration of the bow across the strings. And in the animal kingdom, we know it mostly from crickets, that they rub their wings together really fast and make noise. Tenrecs have a little patch of prickles on their back that, if I read the article correctly, they kind of turn rather than bending in and out, that they actually turn sideways in the hair follicle or spine follicle somehow. Do you remember in the video it showed a close-up, which was nice because there's only two pictures of tenrecs in this article. So watching the video is definitely worth it. What was different about the spines that make the noise? Did you notice?
They looked like claws.
Yeah, they were shorter and thicker and white. And what it showed was that there was a little one and it had stopped to do what?
Eat a worm.
Right. Yeah, that's one of the things. There are quite a few different species of tenrec. And some of them, the smallest ones, are less than 2 inches long. So only like, I think it said 7 centimeters, so around 2 inches long. And very, very light. Only, what was it, less than 10 grams, which you have to use grams for something that small. That's like less than a teaspoon of water. That's how tiny they are. The biggest ones that there are in a couple of zoos in America can get up to over 4 pounds, 2 kilograms, and are more like 7 inches long. And I think the ones that make the noise are those big ones. So I think it's this one, the lowland streaked tenrec, which is the kind you'll find at the zoo, that makes a noise. The little one had realized it didn't know where the big ones were, and why couldn't it just walk back up to them? What had happened?
It had wandered too far off eating worms.
Well, it had actually stayed still, and everybody else had wandered off, and it was in the dark. Tenrecs are all nocturnal. What's that mean, Samuel?
At the nighttime?
Right. They're awake at night. The striped ones are lowland streaked ones. Part of why they like it for zoos, besides they're bigger so you can actually see them, is they're the only ones that will be awake both at night and during the day, rather than just hiding out all night. All of them like to eat bugs and worms. Some of them will eat a few different things, but that's our main diet. And they live in all kinds of environments. What's cool, some of them live up in the trees, some of them dig holes, and some of them spend quite a lot of time in the water. They have specialized webbed feet. There's quite a variety. Do you remember where most of them live?
Africa.
There are a few in Africa, but do you remember that big island off the coast of Africa on the east side?
Australia?
That is a big island, but it's not just off the coast of Africa. Madagascar. Yeah, one of the videos we saw even said, these animals are actually from Madagascar, not like the movie. One of the things that I liked, of course, being in the Answers magazine, is it points out how they're confusing to the evolutionists. It says, in fact, biologists struggle to classify tenrecs. Creation scientists believe they belong to their own separate created kind. In Wikipedia, they said tenrecs are widely diverse. As a result of convergent evolution, they resemble hedgehogs, shrews, opossums, mice, and even otters. Now, I don't think I've discussed convergent evolution with you two. So let me just describe what is going on in evolutionary thinking that they would use something like convergent evolution. That means to converge means to come together from two different places or more than one different place. Like when we go to church, everyone converges on that building from all around the area. So they're saying, even though they look like hedgehogs and these other animals, nobody thinks that their great-great-grandparents were hedgehogs or mice or otters. That instead, they changed to be very similar just because, and it just worked that way that they changed to be similar. Convergent evolution can explain anything. You've got two things that evolutionists say. They'll say, okay, we've all got the same number of bones in our arms, whether we're an animal is a horse or a whale or a human. Therefore, we all came from one ancestor that had that number of bones. But if they say, well, these didn't come from the same ancestor, but they still have the same things, therefore they just developed it over and over and over again independently. So whatever they see, they always say it's because of evolution. If it's the same, well, obviously. If it's different, well, that can happen too. So there's no way for them to ever look at the facts and say, wait a minute, maybe something else caused them to have similar features. What do we know about hedgehogs and mice and otters and tenrecs? Who gave them their prickles?
God.
God did. And could God use the same idea in different animals that he created separately from the very beginning? Could he use the same idea?
Yes.
Of course he could. It would be silly for him not to use the same idea. The most famous example of convergent evolution where it's just like, seriously, is when dolphins and bats use the same system to hear ultrasonically, to know where things are based on the sounds that they're coming back. No one thinks they both have the same common ancestor that could do that. They just say, well, they both developed the same system without ever talking to each other for no reason at all. All right. One of the things, and we would agree with this, Wikipedia also says, all the species from the island of Madagascar, semi-aquatic, the ones that love to swim all the time, or not, appear to have evolved from a single common ancestor. Do we have a problem with all tenrecs having the same ancestor? Does that bother us?
Why would?
What if God made two tenrecs in the beginning and then sent two of them to Noah, and they got off the ark after their year on board, and they started walking and swimming down to Africa and got out to Madagascar, and then they had some children that were one bigger and some children that were smaller and some children that had more webbed feet and some children that didn't. Would that make us say, oh, no, the Bible's wrong. God can't have designed them?
No.
Of course not. God's perfectly capable of stuffing all kinds of information into the animals he sent to Noah, and then they could have all kinds of different children. The San Diego Zoo is one of the places that has a lowland streaked tenrec, and they have a rather long article with almost no pictures. It was kind of disappointing. But one of the things that caught my eye was this. It says, tenrecs retain primitive characteristics that were likely widespread in early placental mammals, including a low and variable body temperature. Primitive is a word. Prime. Do you remember what prime means?
New.
New. Very. Yeah, that is one of the definitions. It means first. So when they talk about primitive, what they're saying is these are the first. And in evolutionary thinking, in old world thinking, primitive means early and not very developed. It hasn't gotten as complicated as it will later. So primitive in their idea is not a good thing. For us, I love studying primitive cultures because they're so close to Babel and Noah's Ark and stuff, and they have some incredibly brilliant designs. I recognize that just because something is close to the beginning does not make it simpler. It can if you're just getting settled and you don't have time to set up a fancy culture. But anyway, for animals to say primitive characteristics, here's what they're saying. They have no evidence of this whatsoever, but they imagine that long ago when there were only a few mammals, that placenta is how the baby grows inside of a mammal mommy's tummy. That's where your belly button comes from. It's where your placenta came out of you. That's how you survived before you were born. And that's true for all regular mammals that aren't marsupials. So they imagine that such early animals would all have had where their body temperature could change a lot more, where you weren't always the same inside temperature, whether it's hot or cold outside. So they're just guessing it. And at least they were willing to say it's were likely, but still they're suggesting that we're just guessing, but we think it really was this way. So they do that all the time. Watch for words like that. First of all, they're making huge assumptions that there were early placental mammals. And then watch for words like were likely rather than saying we know, because they don't know. It's entirely a guess. So I was very pleased and excited to see what they had in the Answers magazine. The rest of it is chock full of all kinds of things. They've got vestigial organs and how gene editing is happening. And there's one guy trying to edit his own genetics so that his muscles can get bigger in his body than they otherwise are allowed to. Because there's actually something that God put into us to stop us from becoming like the Incredible Hulk. There's a really good article that I very much appreciate on Isaac Newton, because he was an amazing guy, but we will not see him in heaven because he didn't believe Jesus was God. And then, of course, the big, long article on seashells is just fascinating. So although Answers Magazine does cost money, it is well worth the investment. It doesn't have that much for children. It's got the little pullout, but there are lots of beautiful pictures. And certainly for your parents and for about middle school and up, it really is something that can be a huge blessing to your family if you can possibly invest in it. And I am so pleased. They do an amazing job. The layout, it is as a professional. They have won awards in Christian publications for the quality of their photography and layout and how careful they are putting everything together. So it's always worth your time to read through, and you are bound to learn all kinds of things getting the Answers magazine. So kudos to Answers in Genesis, and it was so exciting to learn about the tenrec. Pretty amazing, huh?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now it's time to hear from you. What do you have for us today, Samuel?
A dinosaur schoolwork course.
All right, so I'll get this set up. A while back, I'd run into schoolhouseteachers.com, and their online collection of resources and courses for homeschoolers. And they had some on science. So I asked them, hey, where do you stand on how and when God created? And they wrote me right back and said, we are absolutely young earth creationists. We believe when God said he created in Genesis that he meant he made everything in six literal days and the flood was real. It was like, awesome. So since then, I have had a link to their program on my shop page, which you can visit at creationscience4kids.com/shop. And then I decided to join myself. And actually, what I did, because it does cost some money compared to a full curriculum, it's very affordable and they are working hard. They nearly have enough. So you could use just their program, only use it for your homeschool. And then, of course, use books and stuff you get from the library. But you could use them. They have enough courses collected to do every subject in every grade, or very nearly so. Anyway, so I wanted to join, and what I did was put together a course for podcasting. So I did some videos and sent them, or asked them, and they said, yeah, we'd be very interested. So I show, if you want to learn how to become a podcaster, and I'm especially focused on high schoolers becoming podcasters. So that's how I got in. If you are interested in a family checking this out and click through from my link, I will get a substantial commission for that. It won't cost you any extra, but if like two of you sign up, that will be enough to cover our next year, because I posted my podcast article a year ago and we definitely use it. As long as you have internet and your kids have access to the screens, it's all done. How? What did you do to take this course?
A video.
It was a series of videos. So nearly everything is done with video, where you get to see the teacher, or in this case, you see him just Rockman Pat just a little bit, and then it has slides that he shows. So when this was posted, it's one of their newest courses. This is the same guy from out at Northwest Treasures that Steve and I had done a review of their early geology book for young students. So when I saw that he had done a course for schoolhouse teachers, it's like, oh yeah, we got to check this out. So what was his course about? Was it about rocks and minerals?
Dinosaurs?
Yes. And there was a series of 16 videos.
Yes.
And each of them, how long were they? Were they like an hour long each?
No. Like the most is 12 minutes something seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And the least is like 7 minutes and a couple seconds.
Oh, there was one that short. And the ending is just reminding that you can go to his website. Like if you want your own bit of a dinosaur fossil, he sells them. So they're actually a little shorter. So yeah, it wasn't that long a course. What were your favorite things to learn?
That one dinosaur is 16 inches tall, mm-hmm, and like 8 feet long.
Whoa, so very low and long? Huh. When they talk about what dinosaurs do, mm-hmm, what they ate, where they lived, are they doing it because they saw the dinosaurs doing those things?
No, because people wrote it down.
And mm-hmm, where did they get the ideas to write it down? Did they just imagine it all?
No.
No. But what do they have since they didn't get to watch them?
Mm.
What's all that we have left of dinosaurs?
They're fossils.
Right. So, like, I know one of the ones you were listening to towards the end was Oviraptor, where they named it Oviraptor as if it liked to eat eggs, because did they see it with an egg caught in its throat that it was swallowing?
No.
What did they find?
They found a dinosaur bone near some eggs.
Right. And they guessed from that it obviously wasn't the same kind of dinosaur. Therefore, they figured, oh, it must have been wanting to eat it. And then later they're like, wait a minute. Maybe they didn't really have anything to do with each other. They just got buried together. So he points out some things about how people study fossils. You saw where they were trying to figure out how fossils first went together when they were discovering these. Was it easy for them to figure out how all the bones go together?
No.
Why not?
Because they have to find the exact bones.
Right. And what happens a lot of times? Do we find a whole skeleton together?
No.
No, that's very rare to find. We've got some of the more complete ones have like 93% of the bones. That's pretty good. But still, you never find a dinosaur with all its bones all in place. So it's like putting together a puzzle.
And what else? Do we find one dinosaur and then it'll be a mile away to the next dinosaur? What happens in a lot of places where we find dinosaur bones? Didn't it show like that wall with all the dinosaur bones sticking out?
Yes.
So what would is that just one dinosaur?
No, it's a whole lot of other dinosaurs.
Right.
Or fossils.
Right. So if you can imagine trying to put together a puzzle where you've got actually 50 jigsaw puzzles all mixed together and a lot of the pieces are missing. Yeah, that would be crazy to try to put together. What about what he said about the ceratops family?
There's this one dinosaur in the Triceratops family that I like. Its ears, it's like has horns on its ears.
It's not an ear. It's like the frill back behind. Yeah. So it has horns on the frill. What's cool about it? Does it look fancy?
Yeah, it looks cool that it has like spikes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he talked about like how to classify all different species because it doesn't work with our normal classification system because like one of the rules for whether something is in the same species or not is can it get married and have babies together? Can we tell that with dinosaur bones?
No.
No, never. So trying to figure out where one species or one family, one kind stops and another starts can be very difficult. So he showed a cool picture of like how many different head shapes did it show on the Ceratops family? Were there like two or three?
Like 12?
Yeah, there were about a dozen different designs. You had everything from the Protoceratops, which has just a plain frill on its neck, then the Triceratops that we're used to seeing, like in movies and stuff, and then it had some of the ones, there were several different varieties that had all those horns. Some of them was like, how in the world did those even grow? So yeah, I thought he did a pretty good job laying it out. Some of it was interesting for the younger ones with just cool facts about dinosaurs. But a lot of it, like I let you skip two of the videos because it was on the philosophy of how paleontologists, people who study fossils, how they think and decide what they're going to accept as history. Now, as a mom and as a content producer, I found his style a little dry. It wasn't exactly boring, but it wasn't as exciting as dinosaurs could be. There's plenty of room. Like, if you know a high schooler who's very good at presenting and loves to research, if they were to do a series of videos and can make it fun and fascinating for kids, there's lots of room for you out there to think of becoming one of the content creators yourself. But for the most part, I found what he had to say was right on. I did disagree when he got to how we classify animals and talked about Linnaeus, who I believe we will see in heaven. He was annoyed at Linnaeus or saying he was wrong to have classified human beings as mammals. I can see why and agree that when you start thinking of us as animals, that it does twist how we think about the weak and the small and human beings as general, that if it's wrong to kill a human, then why do we allow animals to die? That kind of thing I can see, but when you look at our bodies, we do have mammal bodies. It's just our spirit that makes us something more. The other thing, when I was a girl, do you know what my favorite dinosaur was? I still like the whole classification, the sauropods. And he talked about different things that had happened and how paleontology was having trouble or just making major mistakes. And talked about the brontosaurus. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
It's one of the larger sauropods. And originally it had been found without a skull. And the guy just, like I talked about earlier, where you've got all these bones all scrambled together. So he kind of just picked one that he thought fit and called it Brontosaurus. And this was back in the 1800s. So then scientists were like, wait a minute, that's not right. You can't just stick any old skull that you think fits on a dinosaur. This isn't real. And they were right about that, too. So for quite a while, Brontosaurus was considered to be not a real dinosaur. Now, I had a book that still talked about Brontosaurus as real, and then I was like a young teen when I found out that they were saying, wait a minute, that was not done properly. But then, you know, just about 4 years ago, they found that he'd actually guessed right, that the kind of head he had was not the same as Apatosaurus, that Brontosaurus is a legitimate classification for a subset of that small group of the sauropod dinosaurs. So Rockman Pat did not mention that Brontosaurus has been reinstated. So although there's plenty of room for improvement on schoolhouseteachers.com, it is an amazing resource for teaching all kinds of subjects for homeschoolers, and they do have this on dinosaurs. They've got a couple other apologetics origins related, and certainly anything they have covering science is going to be showing itself that they are biblical creationists who take the Bible seriously. So if you're homeschooling, that's certainly a resource that I would check out. Our families enjoyed it. I know one of my sons had taken the math for a while we were looking for a new curriculum, and he really enjoyed the math teacher that they had. So that's something to check out. And if you do decide to go with it for your family, it doesn't cost you any extra. Just click through from my link, and that will help make it possible for me to continue to access this resource for my own family. So kudos to the Schoolhouse Teachers, and they're a subset of the old Schoolhouse magazine, and they are very actively young earth creationists. They are worth supporting. They are such a blessing to all of us interested in and involved in homeschooling. So they're ones that I want to actively recommend, and I'm excited to see what they're doing. And if you check out their Homeschool with Heart blog, you can see what I have to say as a homeschool mom and homeschool grad myself on things far beyond creation science.
Don't forget that you can find all the links to all the things we've talked about today by visiting the show notes page, creationscience4kids.com/Tenrecs or 074.
And to connect with all the rest of the things we do with the podcast, stop by the web address I got just for you, CS4KS, that's the initials of the show, .com. And find out how to send us your own recording. Write us an Apple Podcast review, drop us a note, become a monthly supporter, and see the heart of why this ministry is so important. Speaking of which, running this podcast and the website ministry isn't free, and it takes a lot of my time. I can't go out and earn a living and keep this up. We now have a Patreon account where you can help us out, like Pastor Brian Bedworth does, and the Academy of Christian Apologetics for Moms. Thank you. If just a few of our listeners help, even with just $1 a month, it will help cover the rest of our basic expenses, and anything above that will help us improve things for the future. Visit cs4ks.com to find out how you can get involved. Now it's time for the science joke of the day. What's a scientist's favorite kind of gum?
I don't know.
Experiment. Well, this finishes up our show for today. Until next time, have fun treasuring our amazing universe and creator. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. Revelation 4:11.